Yes.
Am I? I'm on Facebook.
Can you guys turn that light back on, please?
Can you turn that light back on?
Which one? Yeah, one at the back would be great, so I can read my own notes. Yay! Okay. Hi. Thanks for coming. The first thing I'm going to say is that this has nothing to do with legislation or the vast majority of my internship. But I had to do a presentation, sorry that I'm dead again, on something, and my degree did a lot on evolution and biology, so I decided to do this on the evolution of cats. Disclaimer as well, my Latin is obviously not fluent, so if I mess up anything that you have prior knowledge of, please let me know. And if you're confused at any point, please also let me know. And then any questions that you have, I can deal with at the end. Okay. So right now, we have a debated kind of 40 species. I say debated because, you know, there's kind of, is the European wildcat the same as the Scottish wildcat? Is the clouded leopard the same as the thunder clouded leopard? So there is a lot of scientific debate about actually how many species of cat we have. But we have two kind of subfamilies of cats, and these are the Pantherinae, so our big cats, and our Felinae, which are all of the other smaller cats. Okay, so this kind of, we were meant to go to a different slide that essentially explained how, what a family is, what a subfamily is, and that's just like a bit of scientific background, so if anyone does need that clarification at the end of the PowerPoint, I can go to that. And it basically says, obviously, all cats are mammals, they're carnivores, they're within the suborder Feliformia, which has a number of different animals in, like baby cakes. So African genets are also in that overarching family, and this kind of goes down level to level. So you have your Feliformia, and then you have your Felidae, which are all of your cats. And then your Felinae, for example, which are your smaller cats. And then you'd have your species, so like serval or caracal. So how long have cats been around? So the first ancestor of today's modern cats was found in the Oligocene. And that's a big fancy word for 25 million years ago, basically. And it is believed that all cats evolved from one common ancestor. However, the fossil records are very tricky to rely on. And it's very difficult to get exact genetic picture of the exact evolution of cats because it's like a giant jigsaw puzzle and we're only finding, like, let's say, 5 pieces out of 100. And we kind of think based on the skull shape, any bones we may find, any evidence where they were found, and we use that to kind of make a picture of how the cats evolved. So we have found fossils of the first ancestor, but whether it was actually the first and what its offspring and ancestors exactly all look like, we don't know. So I'm basically telling you that everything I'm saying is a guesstimate. So, just because a fossil is found somewhere doesn't mean that it's from that location. It may have lived in all these other different locations but only been found in what is now France, and that doesn't necessarily mean that it comes from France. So the oldest cat relative is this guy here. His name was Proelurus, which is Latin for literally first cat. And he, or she, whichever this species was about the size of an ocelot. It had a more primitive, kind of longer skull than most cats today, and the fossil has been discovered in Mongolia, Germany, and Spain. And it lived in Eurasia, we think, kind of in that area. So its offspring would go on to evolve into all Feliformia today. So you can kind of see the similarity between baby cakes and this guy. So he's the ancestor to all modern cats and Feliformia, so genets and civets, etc., and other carnivores that we have today. So the ancestors of this cat would travel to Asia, Africa, Europe, North America, and South America. Using land bridges that formed as a result of ice ages and melting periods. So the Bering Strait, which connected Asia to America, and then the Isthmus, which is one of my new favorite words, of Panama, which connected North America to South America. So the next fossil relic that we find was this guy. which in Latin is Sudalurus. Mm-hmm. And this guy lived about 20 million years ago. And the family of cat, again, this guy we think originated in Eurasia, but also did spread to North America. And there were lots of many species within this family. So they ranged in size from something small as a wild cat today, it's about this big, to a cougar, and you all know how big a cougar is. This guy was the ancestor of all of the Felidae, so all cats. Whereas the guy before was ancestor of all Feliformia, this guy ancestor of all cats. So that is your conical tooth cats and your saber tooth cats. So saber tooth, obviously, are the ones that have the giant teeth, and conical tooth are all of the cats that we have now. So I'm giving you a lot of information, and you guys can guess that the big cat family tree is kind of big. And it looks like this. So in orange, or as Jen said yesterday, salmon pink, at the bottom right-hand corner, we have the two families of cats that exist now. And every other single cat on that tree was a family of saber-toothed cats. So that just goes to show you how many saber-toothed cats there were. There were a lot. And everyone says, oh, the saber-toothed tiger, the saber-toothed cat, as if it's one singular species. Whereas in reality, there were many, many different species. So saber-toothed tigers did not look like this. They looked nothing like a tiger. So their whole group of saber-toothed cats is actually called Cheirodontinae, which apparently in Latin kind of translates to knife tooth. And this is because researchers and scientists think that they use their teeth like knife. So we actually have a tooth here, which is really fun, because Jen never gets to use it, because we don't have any saber tooth cats here. We can't educate the kids about them. But we have a replica, so essentially it's like as if you held a knife in your hand and did that with it, and that's how they would clamp down on their prey. However, they're not alive right now, so these are all guesses based on their bone morphology and structure as to how they actually lived their lives. So they were found in all continents except from Australia, and they lived from 23 million years ago to about 11 to 12,000 years ago. So that's just over 20 million years of saber-toothed cats being one of the dominant carnivores on this planet. And what a lot of people do not realize is that everything that we call a saber-toothed cat isn't necessarily a true cat. So there were lots of mammals that had four legs and some fur with big teeth that roamed around in other areas of the world, such as Australia, but they developed these big teeth as a result of convergent evolution. And convergent evolution is, as it says up here, the process whereby organisms, so animals that are unrelated, evolve in similar ways to deal with their similar environments. So saber-toothed cats had many other kind of, other animals that they had to compete with, so competitors, but they were very dominant because they had evolved to deal with the large animals that were in their landscape. So the woolly rhino, the woolly mammoth, large sloths, because they were very strong in the front of their bodies and they had huge teeth, they were able to take these animals down, which is why they were so dominant. So they coexisted at the same time as the Pantherinae and the Felinae, because these guys started evolving about 15 million years ago. So they existed at the same time, but the cats that we have today were definitely not dominant. So there were only a few small species dotted here and there, because the saber-toothed cats were the most aggressive on the landscape. So the most famous saber-toothed cat is the Smilodon, and that's because it was the American cat. So naturally, when Hollywood is putting on a film, they go, oh, I know the one, that's the one that the researcher found, yeah, that's the one that we're going to use in our films. So everyone kind of thinks that the only saber-toothed cat looks like Diego from Ice Age, whereas in reality, they had many different appearances. There were three species that lived in America, and they ranged in size from 160 to 620 pounds.
So imagine like 1.5 Nikitas coming at you with giant teeth, being a lot more active than Nikita is, and that is kind of what a saber-toothed Smilodon looked like. And the most well-preserved fossils we have found in Los Angeles, and that's in the La Brea tar pits, and these are essentially pits that have tar in them that come up from underground that back in the day would trap giant megafauna in them, so like woolly mammoths, etc. Well, obviously they were more north, so bison, American camel, and then the cats would see them in those tar pits. They'd go into the tar pits and they'd be stuck themselves and it would suck everyone under. And the fossils are really detailed from that time. So we can actually get like full skeletal understanding of what these animals did look like. Okay, so unfortunately, these guys did go extinct. It would be pretty cool if we had a big cat saber tooth rescue today. However, we do not. Just imagine that, guys. So their extinction, unfortunately, did occur. But they, the first kind of extinction happened because their habitat was disappearing. So about 1 million years ago, Europe had a huge climate cooling event. And that meant that the saber-toothed cats that lived in the areas near the equator, they first started going extinct. And then later, about 50,000 years ago, they started competing with humans. So obviously, humans were wiping out prey, the woolly mammoth. You could see so many cave paintings of people going after these giant megafauna. And that started happening as well. And as these animals were going extinct, the entire ecosystem essentially collapsed. So they became extinct, definitely, completely, about 12,000 years ago, along with woolly mammoths, woolly rhinos, direwolves, which did actually exist. It's not just Game of Thrones. And other types of animals, so like large sloths, like Sid. Sid is based on a large sloth. And they all went extinct at that time. So saber-toothed cats obviously existed over a period of about 20 million years. And they were really dominant in their ecosystems. So we're going back to the family tree. So at the same time as all of this was going on, and saber-toothed cats were killing everything that they saw, the Pantherinae and the Felinae were plodding along quite slowly, not really doing anything because they couldn't get big because they were already big cats and other carnivores. However, 12,000 years ago, these cats started getting big. So the reason that they survived the major extinction event is that their prey was small, and small prey can survive in smaller areas. So it meant that the smaller cats could survive through that major extinction event into today. So the Pantherinae were pretty small until about 6 million years ago when they finally started to be able to become the top apex predator. So here's another very complicated family tree. I've had some fun with them over the past few weeks, so I do apologize. So the oldest of the Pantherinae fossil was only actually discovered 7 years ago. So in 2010, it was found in Tibet. And then, like, this just gives you an idea of how much our knowledge is changing all the time. So everything I'm saying now may be completely irrelevant in 50 years' time when they revolutionize a new way to age fossils and find different and new fossils. So we think that this cat existed 6 million years ago. Obviously, because the Pantherinae had been evolving for about 15 million years, it had previous ancestors. We just have no idea what they look like. And the only thing that we found of this Panthera blithae was what you're seeing up there. So they found a skull. So all of our estimations are based on a very old, weathered, buried underground for a long time skull. So we think it was slightly smaller. We know it preyed on meat. That's pretty much the only thing that we can kind of definitely for certain give you. Obviously, many other researchers and scientists do have their own opinion. So we think, based on where it was found and its skull shape, that it was most closely related to the snow leopard, but that is, again, kind of a guess. So there are many extinct members of the Pantherinae family, and the ones that we have today have little orange stars next to them, and the ones that we do not have do not, especially the skulls. So some of these species included Panthera zidanski, which is the skull in the middle, and this was a cat. We think similar in body shape to the tiger, but didn't look anything like the tiger, that lived in northwest China. Again, we know little about it, but we do know a lot about the Eurasian cave lion. So he's the guy down in the bottom right-hand corner. And the Eurasian cave lion is really very heavily referenced in European prehistoric art. So in cave paintings, you'll see the little stick men with the spears, and then the Eurasian cave lion with them or being chased by them, etc. So people have worked out that this guy did definitely exist when humans were here and was quite an apex and feared predator in the regions it inhabited. So it's thought that all of these cats originated somewhere in the Asian rainforest about 11 million years ago. However, the clouded leopard, we think, started diverging, so evolving into its own species about 9 to 10 million years ago. And that's why the clouded leopard is so very different from all the cat species we have today. So they have wrists that rotate 180 degrees, which allows them to climb vertically up and down. So they can actually turn their body kind of the other way, facing completely down and climb, because their wrists can rotate. So their claws as well, I don't believe they completely retract. They just have claws that are kind of out all the time, and that means that they are really well adapted to climbing trees. And it's thought that the original cats lived in trees. So they didn't cross grasslands like they do today or forests, but they did prey on smaller species up in trees. So scientists think the tiger and the snow leopard diverged about 4 million years ago. And the leopard, lion, and jaguar, they kind of diverged into their own thing about 3.5 million years ago, and then they all split up, but that is scientifically debated about when they did. So you can see that we have the leopards and jaguars in the bottom left, and we have the two different types of jaguar. So we did have a European jaguar. And then the lion and the Eurasian cave lion down in the bottom right. So the reason that there are so many different species of cat is to do with survival. So you guys know cats compete for prey. They are food aggressive. And because cats compete for prey and territory, they are hardwired to disperse generation after generation so they don't have to compete with their own siblings or parents. And as they disperse, they encounter new landscapes. And these landscapes essentially mean that they adapt. So the further north they go, the colder it gets, they adapt to that. And these adaptations have essentially given us the cats that we have today. So I'm just gonna go through my notes very quickly because I've totally lost track of that. Okay, so for example, as cats moved north into the Himalayas, the snow leopard started existing. And as cats kind of moved from different place to different place, so the plains of Africa, they adapted to taking down large prey that was existing in that time. But it's difficult to know where these cats are actually from because they move around so much, because they are, like I said, hardwired to disperse. So we actually think that the ancestor of the leopard started off in Africa and it became the leopard, and then it moved back to Asia. So it went from Asia to Africa and then back to Asia again. And essentially these adaptations have given us the adaptations of big cats that we have today. So the stereotypical tiger in the grass, its stripes break it up, means it can survive and hunt its prey. So, at the same time that the larger cats were evolving, so were the smaller cats. There's a debate to which kind of line started evolving first. So I'm not going to exactly tell you when, because I read a lot of different papers and they all said different things. However, what we do know is when the Macherodontinae, so the saber-toothed cats, went extinct, these guys became incredibly popular and they kind of spread all over the landscape to give us the huge number of small cat species that we have today. And Asia is where we think they originated from.
So, hopefully this works. It's believed that the first split was the American cheetah. So this was a cheetah that lived in America that was the descendant of today's modern cougar and our African cheetah of today. So 9 million years ago, the bay cat lineage formed, and this is your bay cats, marbled cats, and all of them inhabit forested areas pretty much in Southeast Asia. The next split was the caracal lineage, and I'm fully aware that caracals do not live in South Africa. That's just where I have space to put them. So obviously that is also your sand cats, your servals, your caracals, etc. 8 million years ago was the ocelot lineage, and it is believed that they crossed into America. So obviously not that way around over the ocean, but the other way around the back by Alaska. Yep. So that's how we think they got to South America. And that includes your margays, cod-cods, the pampas cat, etc. And then 7 million years ago, the lynx lineage started splitting. So that's your Iberian lynx and your Canada lynx. And obviously all the other lynxes as well. So your Eurasian lynx too. And then 6 million years ago, the ancestors of the Asian leopard cat, the palace cat, and the fishing cat, this is my favorite, they started diverging into their own kind of group of species. And so just like bigger cats, there have been many smaller cats that have gone extinct. Sorry, I forgot this one. This is Jura. I worked with her before, and that is our last evolution of lineage of our smaller cats, and that is our wild cats, our black-footed cats, and the smaller cats that we do have today, the more generalist species. So, just like with our bigger cats, again, like I said, there have been many small cats that have gone extinct. So, the North American cheetah, which was the ancestor to obviously the cougar and the cheetah of today. And cats such as the Martelli's cat, which is thought to have been the ancestor to the modern European wild cat, a smaller lynx species. And there was also a type of bobcat that was about the size, I'm going to say the size of a lynx, but still a bobcat, and that used to exist as well. And it kind of existed about 4 million years ago. Size of a lynx bobcat with short legs. So if you can all picture that, that did exist. So as we know, today's modern cats are extremely adapted to their environments. We see that here at Big Cat Rescue. So you guys all see Gilligan and Skipper's paws. They're meant for the snow. They eat the snowshoe hare. That's what they're good at doing, okay? And then we have, you know, our caracals. Obviously, Sassy is not the best example of what apex caracal should look like. But, you know, they have strong hind legs. They are meant to live in their environment. They're meant to take down birds and fly. You know, they have every adaptation that is meant for living in Northern Africa and the Middle East. And then you have cats like the sand cat, who, did you know, actually drink the blood of their prey to keep them hydrated in the desert. Pretty cool, definitely adapted to where they're living. However, this is an issue right now for all of these cats. Whereas in the past, their adaptations meant that they were able to survive fantastically in their environment, these environments are now changing, and these cats are not adapted to change. So generalists will survive. For example, the bobcat. We all know the bobcats can pretty much live anywhere. They will cross roads, they will live in people's backyards, they will dig through your trash. They are very generous species, and in the future, we may actually see a rise in the increase of generalist species. So for example, like the urban fox, coyotes, bobcats, as these are species that can survive in urban areas. However, many of our small cats are pretty endangered. For example, the fishing cat and the flat-headed cat, who are in the bottom left, they are extremely adapted to their wetland environments. Both of them have webbing on their toes to some degree. However, they pretty much live in mangroves, and these are disappearing as a result of aquaculture, shrimp and fish farms. You know, most of their diet they do get from water, and that is being polluted as well. So unfortunately, these cats are kind of facing the end of their adaptation. They've adapted too much,
And that's the same with the Iberian lynx, who pretty much just preys on rabbits in southern Spain, which sounds like a great life personally. However, due to people owning pet rabbits and then being released, etc., and the rise of agriculture in the area, these rabbits have contracted diseases, which means that their prey is essentially being depleted. Obviously, along with habitat loss, that is a huge factor. But these guys can't just move northwards up into the Alps or the Pyrenees and go start hunting, like, you know, small other rabbits that are slightly colder, fluffier, and more white. Okay, they just can't do that. They have no idea how to. They are so adapted to where they are. And the same with the cheetah. So previously, the cheetah was adapted to run. And that was fine because it had an abundance of prey to run after. Now, however, with prey depleting, it's running and it's getting its prey. It's adapted to do that, but a hyena will come up to it, square off with it, and because they're so slim, they're slender, they can't fight those other cats off. They don't do that. So most of the time, bigger predators, so lions or hyenas, will take their prey away from them. Previously, that wasn't an issue. They just deal with that and be like, all right, I'll run after the next thing. But it's getting to the point where there is no next thing to run after, and that is really an issue. It can't suddenly become like a climber and start going after monkeys. It is bred to run. That was meant to go through all of that. Sorry. Okay. So the last bit of our evolutionary kind of series comes to our domestic cat. So these guys are descended from African wild cats. And we know that because we've done genetic testing. Fine. So, however, the progression of domestication saw many failed beginnings. And this is a lesson that everyone should learn from today, is that you cannot just take a wild animal into your house and expect it to behave the way you want it to. So people would raise these cats, it would have litters. They didn't have kitten carriers back then, so obviously these cats would go out, they'd come back in, they'd lose them. These people were very migratory. Settlements were a thing, but people were moving still much more than they are today. And these cats would get lost, they wouldn't come with them, they'd escape back into the wild. So we think it took about 5,000 years for them to actually become a species that only lived in the house, that became a house cat. And this obviously occurred with the rise of agriculture. So we think these kind of failed beginnings occurred all over the Fertile Crescent, which is an area essentially north enough of the equator that it's not too hot, but south enough of the North Pole that it's not too cold. And that is where agriculture began, because plants could grow and the soil was good and the sunlight was fine. And we actually see the rise of the domestic cat, as well as several other species, like the brown rat, and mice, that occurred at the same time as the domestic cat. And it's kind of cool to see the evolution together, because obviously agriculture means grain, means mice, means cat. So that kind of all happened in one kind of long thing. So they were super valued. It was like a hot commodity to have a cat in your house. And we can tell this by the way that they were buried. So we have found evidence that 6,000 years ago, people dug up a kind of old burial site in Cyprus and found that the head of the household was buried next to his cat. So these cats were working animals at this point. So they were valued because they kept the rodents away from the grain, which was the money, the income, and the food for that family. And about by 4,000 years ago, we had cats in our homes. And this is when they started not just being working animals, but companion animals too. And we can tell this because they were intricately wrapped, and I know mummies can freak people out, definitely me, but it just goes to show how valuable they were. They were a symbol of maternity, childhood, the house in ancient Egypt, and we can see that by hieroglyphics and the way that they were buried. And about 2,000 years ago, we started breeding for characteristics that we like. So I don't know much about domestic cat breeds. I just see it as a cat and I'm like, I love it! However, there are other people that breed for specific colours. For example, Siamese cats, you have your Sphinx cats, like Cornish Rex, all these weird ones that I think look great regardless of how much hair they have on them. But people, you know, have been going crazy with that. And now we have over 70 breeds of domestic cats.
Like this one here.
Trish! So that is kind of the end of the evolution of cats. So I know it was a lot of information all at once. And if anyone has any questions, I will hope to answer them. If I can't, I'll just smile.
I learned so much from that.
Thank you. Meg!
Hey. So, when you were talking about leopards, how, you know, they went down to Africa, kind of became leopards up there, went back to Asia, and then we have the Asian leopards. Mm-hmm. Is there any kind of assumption that Asian leopards, having gone back to a different climate again, have they not had enough time to evolve separately, or those adaptations they gained in Africa, those also work in a different environment?
That's a really good question. So they are not a separate species yet. However, who knows, due to the fact that they're very isolated from one another right now, in a few thousand years they could be. So yes, because they are completely so closely related, it is definitely assumed that what they learn in Africa, or what they adapted to and became a species of in Africa, applied as well in Asia. And you do see them living in similar environments in both continents. Any more questions? Yes.
At the very beginning, cats, where they had coats, are those coats just a guesstimate?
Yeah, okay. That's a complete, that's an artistic person being like, I think it had spots. That we know so little about these previous fossils other than what we get. So, for example, people have done kind of whole artistic representations of the saber-toothed cats. They could be pink. We have no idea. You know, we just found out that dinosaurs had feathery tails. These, who knows, these guys could have had feathers. Like, we literally have absolutely no idea about what their coats were, just their bone structure. Any other questions? Yes, Meg.
So are we guesstimating their weights? Because there were quite specific weights about, you know, 200s up to 620 and things.
Yeah, so their weights are easier to guess because we have found fossils. So complete, if you find, like, even a partial skeleton, you can work out kind of what the rest of the skeleton would look like, and then they kind of say, well, what would a carnivore's muscle mass look like, how much muscle would they have to fat, etc., and then they can attempt to work out a weight. Yes.
So are we still basing that off of the cats that we see today? Because if they've evolved over so many thousands and millions of years, it could be completely different.
Yes, we are basing that on the cats today. You're right, it could be completely different. If you thought that the saber-toothed cats maybe would have been bulkier in the front, so more muscle mass in the front, quite like a hyena is today. And that again is based on the bone structure as well. And the way we think that they hunted, and the way people a lot cleverer than I am, who know a lot more about biology, would assume their muscles, like the kind of way their muscles worked. Yeah. Anyone else? Yes.
Huge debate on Facebook is what your nationality is.
So I grew up in London and New York and traveled across the ocean many times over the course of my childhood, so I have a funny accent.
All of you who said London, you were right.
Any other questions? Hallelujah. Okay. Thank you.